So tell us about the finale of Dexter. Wait, sorry, that's wrong. So Mayor Rosewater has been like, you know, first she was just giving a lot of speeches, but then it seemed like she became much more active.
Yes.
You know, that, were you happy about that kind of growth of the character?
Yes, definitely. I mean, that was, anytime you have a character grow is exciting as an actor. So, I mean, I knew that in the beginning that was the plan. You really had to set up, somebody had to be the voice of Defiance.
Yes,
Amanda really had to take on that role. And what was interesting is that every character in season one had a dark side, except for Amanda. So it really allowed the audience to get into the world of Defiance and see it through her eyes.
Does that mean she's not going to have a dark side? Are we not going to see anything?
We all have dark sides, don't we? It's just sometimes they're more hidden than others. So I definitely, yeah, we will be exploring her dark side more.
Is she a fun character to play? Is she something you really love to dig your claws into?
I do. And then I love the world of Defiance itself. To create a world of such extremes where you can reset the game at the end of every season and change it. It's exciting. And you're never going to play the same character each season. And, you know, as an actor, that's exciting.
Is it being on the actual set, what is that like for you? How does that help you get into her and that you have a really nice set constructed?
Oh, I've never seen anything constructed for television as what our Defiance set is. We have a 3-street post-apocalyptic town with working buildings, 2 stories up and down, so we're able to shoot within the buildings, inside, outside. And we also have a stage, and then we also have a green screen, and we have a location. But the town itself, it's amazing. You really feel like you're in a whole different world. And I decided one night, within the first couple of weeks of filming, that I was going to explore the town at night with no lights on all by myself.
Oh, God.
That must be scary.
It was scary. It's creepy because they have the weird plants and they got, there's all sorts of, there's like headless mannequins. And, it was really scary. But it's like nothing you've ever seen before.
You know, last year you talked about that you wanted to play a stronger woman. You want to always play, you know, the
mother wife victim.
Yeah, I mean, do you feel like that Amanda's grown into that character? I mean, are you satisfied with what direction it's taking her?
Yes, definitely, definitely. I mean, this is a woman who, you know, held a position of power, who had strength, who was strong, who, you know, I joke around that I really wish Amanda had gotten laid during season one, but she needed it, stress relief. But it was great to actually play a female character where I didn't kiss anybody, I wasn't anybody's girlfriend, I wasn't anybody's wife, you know, and in my almost 30-year career, that's never happened. So it was great all of a sudden to have a female character who was strong and still sexy and all of that, but who wasn't relying on.
Yeah, that whole victim, wife.
Yeah, and so I actually could just stand alone and just be a strong female character.
And we decided to lose your ex-boyfriend, Gail.
Ex-husband,
that's right. Ex-husband, sorry, you're right.
Those Rosewater girls, they go after the same boy. Poor Amanda doesn't stand a chance. Kenyon knows things. No, it's totally true. And one of my favorite scenes that we shot, I think it was in episode 4, was when Amanda catches Nolan with Kenya in her room. And I love that scene. We shot it many different ways, but I got to play kind of that she's flustered because here's this handsome man that she has an attraction to with her sister, who is a prostitute after all. And, you know, she has a job to do, but she's getting a little flustered, but she still has to do her job. So it was fun to play all those different levels in the scene, and we had a great time shooting it. I mean, Grant and Mia did not make it easy for me. I mean, on my coverage, they were
give me a hard time.
They were making me flustered. Very flustered. Thank you.
What was it like going from, like, you were on Dexter previously to somebody who was very, you know, sheltered, very hurt, your character is very proactive on the show? Because it's a different role. What was it like?
Yeah, and it was something I was actively searching out as an actor, was I wanted to, you know, Rita was amazing, and Rita kind of allowed me to strip away the facade and really be this raw, vulnerable, emotional woman in a time in my life when I needed to do that as an actress. And then when that ended for me, I wanted to find more of a badass character, somebody a little more proactive, you know, somebody who's going to kill someone versus getting killed. You know, job security.
No
You know, there's a weird thing that happens where you attract certain roles in your life as an actor for certain reasons, and you don't really understand it, but it's like a synergy that happens between character and actor. And so, you know, there was a time when I attracted a lot more vulnerable women, and I don't know if it was because of what I was going through in my own personal life or not, but it just was the right fit.
Because even in Angel, you played a tough character, but she's also kind of vulnerable.
Yeah.
And a little bit whiny.
She was whiny?
Well, I'm not whiny.
Someone said Darla was whiny.
Only when she became human. Then she got a little bad.
Well, you humans are whiny. I mean, she had a soul. That's what happens when you get a soul. You whine a little. I feel like I've been very blessed playing very different women and being able to bring different parts of myself to the screen through these characters and reveal different parts of myself through the characters. So I just knock on wood, right?
And what do you think about the strong female fans? Such interesting and unique kind of female roles. And I think women appreciate that. What have been some of the things that women have told you about the types of characters?
No one really relates to being a vampire, and if they do, I kind of run before I hear the finished sentence. I don't want anybody to come and tell me they relate to Darla.
I know.
But, you know, what's great when you play characters within science fiction and genre and supernatural shows is at their core, you have to find the human element that you can relate to. And, like, with Darla, it was that unrequited love, and we've all experienced unrequited love, and she just kind of took it a little too extreme. Like, if she was, like, just a human, you'd be like, she's a stalker, crazy, she'd be thrown in jail for stalking. But, she got away with it as a vampire, because she could just kill the people that complained. With Rita, I had a lot of women write me letters that, watching Rita's journey, you know, from being a victim of physical abuse and domestic violence to growing into, you know, a stronger female, really meant a lot to them because of what they were going through. And it was very emotional for me to read those letters. Sometimes you forget that what you do as an actor has an effect on people, and to have a positive effect especially is the greatest gift, I think. So when I read those letters, they're sharing a part of themselves with me, and it was really emotional and honor in many ways. And then with Amanda, I think for me it was important to find a badass character again, to find a strong woman, but where I could still be a woman, where I didn't have to lose my femininity, but I could be in a position of power and strength, but still be a woman. I mean, we see a lot of examples where women in positions of power all of a sudden become very masculine, and I wanted to keep Amanda feminine still. Like, you know, that was important to honor.